Welcome, everyone. Glad to have you join us to the room with the greatest gravitational pull. This talk is titled ANS Coding Replacing Huffman and AC, From Introduction to Patent Issues, and will be presented by Jarek Duda. Jarek is an assistant professor with the Jagiellon University. Apologies for my pronunciation there.
No problem.
If you have any questions for the talk today, we have our IRC chat open, and Jarek and I are in there. You can ping us for your questions or just write in question. We're happy to take those towards the end. Yes, thanks for coming. Take it away.
Thank you very much for the invitation and for coming. So I have put the slides right in the IRC channel. So I talk about ANS coding, which stands for asymmetric numerical systems, and it is now replacing Huffman and arithmetic coding in many modern data compression. So the purpose is so-called entropy coding. So it is the final stage of most of data compressors. So data compressors first try to split the data into some small chunks, even symbols, and estimated probabilities, and then finally entropy coder like this one is used to translate them into final bits which are stored or transmitted. So for example, here is some sequence of symbols AAC and so on. With Huffman coding, you could encode it into this sequence. So A into 0, B into 1, 0, C into 1, 1 bits. Because A is more frequent, then we would like to use shorter representation for A. So in Huffman, it's 1 or 2 bits, but in practice, we would like to use a logarithm of 1 probability bits for given symbol. So this is only approximation. So Huffman approximates with power of 2, the probability. So the real probabilities are a bit different. And if you use the real probabilities, what can be done in arithmetic or ANS coding, then the representation is usually shorter. So it literally kind of uses fractional bits, like for A here using only half of bit. It's literally asymptotically works like that. So arithmetic coding is usually better, but it's much more costly than Huffman. And INS provides similar compression as arithmetic coding, but it's also very fast. So now it often replaces both modern compressors. So for example, in all Apple devices for like 6 years, there is now by default use ANS-based compressor. There is Facebook standard, for example, in Linux kernel for a few years also. DNA sequencing. So if you have DNA sequencing, probably your data will be written with CRAM compressor. Then there is some Draco, Google Draco 3D compressor, some meshes. There are many network-based compressors using ANS. And finally, there is JPEG XL, which can finally replace the JPEG after 30 years, providing like 3 times smaller files with similar quality as JPEG. Also, the missing features like alpha transparency, HDR, lossless. So recently, it completed ISO standardization. It is supported in many web browsers, but behind the flag in this moment, but in this year, hopefully it will change. And there are many others compressed, like 100 of them. Here is a link with many of them. There was a large community, dozens of people who were just sharing their work, both implementations, articles, ideas. However, so there is also this second kind of community which tries to get monopoly for these methods, and there were a few such attempts, and now it's ongoing another one. So I will also talk about it. So in the past, arithmetic coding was introduced multiple times, 1976 and in further years, but there was lots of patents, and finally it was paralyzed for 30 years by patents. So many of these people wanted to avoid this to repeating this story for ANS. So there is this big question. I don't know the answer. I would like to ask here. How to defend from? So you just put your work into a repository, into academic part, article, and somebody can just write a patent about it, copy paste, and often it will be granted because it is very 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 simple to get granted patent now. So what to do with these kind of situations? I don't know. So I would like to ask some suggestions, and maybe there is some action to improve the situation. Okay, so let's go back to this technical part and then to more patent part. So we have this problem that we have some sequence of symbols which has some complex probability distribution. So notice, and we would like to translate them into bit sequence. So bits have one half probabilities, but the symbols can have much more complex probabilities. So this is the difficulty: how to optimally translate one bit into another. So there is this prefix Huffman codes. So they are very fast. There is no multiplication, but they are not accurate. So they kind of approximate probabilities of symbols with powers of two. So A 1/2, B 1/4, C 1/4. So if these are exact probabilities, it is perfect, but usually they are not. So for example, if there is a probability that is 100 probability for A and 99 probability for B, then Huffman just uses one bit per symbol. So 0 to A, B, 1 to B, that's all. But in theory, we could encode it into 0.08 bits per symbol, so like 12 times better. So and arithmetic coding and ANS can get as close as you want to this 0.0908 bits per symbol for this sequence. So arithmetic coding work like this, that we have a range. It's also called a range coding. So we have a range, and we split this range into sub-ranges according to the probabilities. Then we choose one of the ranges, the sub-ranges, and so on. We split the new sub-range into according to the probabilities and so on. So it can work with better, it can provide better compression ratio, but it is a bit costly from computational perspective. We need to work on this beginning and end of the range. We need multiplications. So now ANS replaces both of them. So there are two based variants used. So one is tablet, that we put all the behavior into a table. So it still do not need multiplication. It can be seen as generalization of Huffman coding. So it can be seen as kind of Huffman with updated fractional bits generalization. Also, we can, inside this table, we could put simultaneous encryption that we both compress and encrypt into this way. So it is used for simpler compressors, so fixed distributions, like this Apple compressor, default compressor, and the standard. From the other side is RANS, which is quite similar to arithmetic coding. Also, we work on ranges. We need multiplications, but we need only one multiplication per symbol, and we work on one value as state, not two. So here we need the two to define the range, and in ANS we need only one. And so, for example, it allows for vectorization and many optimizations. So finally, it gets like 10 times faster in implementations. So often the RANS is used in more advanced compressors, so like JPEG XL, the neural network-based compressors. Okay, so here are some examples of compressors. So the benchmark is 10 gigabyte Wikipedia. So Wikipedia, the first gigabyte of Wikipedia in 10 languages, and this is tarred into one large file. So here is the size final of after compression. Here is the link. There are many more compressors there. At the top you can see that the compression is not very good. These are mainly LibreZip based compressors. This is just a parser that seeing a word, it tries to search this word in the path and say that take this position, these bits from these bytes from this position. So this is kind of just a parser. And so then starting with gzip, there is LibrePlanet, this kind of parser, plus simple entropy coder, here Huffman, and the green, the marked green are using ANS. So there's the standard I have mentioned, so you can see that it's like 6 times faster than gzip in decode beacon and provides better compression. So there are many options, so how good it should be. So here is his first option, his 22nd option. So we can see that the decoding time is still similar, but the encoding times grows like 100 times since. But you get twice better compression here, yes. So the Z standard is very popular now, and Razor is a bit more complex with adaptive runs. Okay, so how does it work? ANS. So here is some very simple example. So in standard binary system, if you would like to encode information in some state natural number X, so this is a simpler way. Say that new state, which contains the old information, the new information is 2 times the old state plus this symbol, this 0, 1 symbol. So we just shift binary by one position and put the new symbol in this significant position. So it is very, very nice and practical, but it's optimal only if the probability distribution of the symbol is 1/2, 1/2. So only then it is really optimal. So if this probability is different, then we can asymmetrize it in ANS. So let's look how we can asymmetrize this rule as above. So here we have every second is even odd numbers. And now you'd like to look at the probability distribution, you see that one is much more frequent than zero. So we would like to use more ones than zero. So we divide here into blocks of four and put 1, 0 and 3, 3 ones, 1, 0, 3 ones, 1, 0, 3 ones, and so on. Then as above, we count, we enumerate the appearances. So of zeros here is zero appearance of zero, first, second, third, and so on. Then for one the same, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Then the encoding rule is as above. So the new state is the number of old state appearance of symbol. So let's look at this example. So we start with some initial state here, 1. So now you'd like to encode symbol 0. So you look at this row 0 and find this appearance of 1 of 0. So we get to 4. Then we would like to encode 1. So we look at row 1 and find appearance of 4, because we are in 4. So we go to 6 and so on. 6, 9, 9, 13, 13, 18. So here we have encoded into 47, this sequence 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, here into 18. So we get a smaller number, so we get a shorter representation, because we have used the fact that 1 is much more likely than 0. So we have adapted to the probability distribution, asymmetrize this binary system to this non-uniform probability distribution. Okay, so let's try to find the formula. So this is one of few technical slides, but okay. So this runs variant about from the patent. So let us go through it. So generally, for symbol of probability, this probability of S. So we would like to increase this X, this our state, to approximately X divided by this probability. So if it was 1/2, then we approximately multiply it by 2. So here for 1/4, we multiply by 4. Here for 3/4, we divide by 3/4, approximately. So here 4, 6, 6, 9, 9, 13. This is approximately multiplying by 4/3. So how to find the formulas? So to encode, So to encode, we need to find the appearance. So to find the appearance inside the block, we need to divide by 4 or 3, and take the floor. So one is for encoding, the second is for decoding. And so this division gives us the number of block of size 4. So we need to multiply by the number of appearances in this block. Then shift by this bias shift inside the block, and we get the formulas. So the formulas are not very difficult. So this is some modulo, some division floor, and so on. So there are a few simple formulas which generalize this numerical system into these asymmetric situations of optimizes for given probability distribution. Okay, so and this Rand's variant I have mentioned, and so this is the general idea that we split the natural numbers into these fixed size ranges here of size 8, and each range is identically split into the subranges according to the probability distribution like the colors, and we get simple formulas to encode with this asymmetric numerical system. So this way we have encoded into a very large natural number. So what is not very practical, because we don't want to work with huge arithmetic. So in practice we add a renormalization to enforcing that this X is some range. So in practice is this, for example, this for 32 bit X is in this range. Here is example for a smaller range for 4 to 7. So for this first small range 4 to 7, we can put into a table the entire behavior. So let's look at this automaton. So we get four state automaton. This is this table variant, so that we put everything into a table. So what's happening here? So the symbol B has probability 1/4, so it carries 2 bits, and using this symbol we indeed always produce these 2 bits, the blue digits, and go to state 5. But symbol A has probability 3/4, so it has smaller than less than 1 bit, so it's like half a bit. So what's happening here? So from state 4 we go to state 6 and don't produce any bits. From 5 to 7 also don't produce any bits. From 7 and 6 we go to 4 and produce 1 bit. So on average we produce like half a bit. Yeah. So indeed, it allows to work with fractional number of bits. And it is like 1/100 from the optimum given by Shannon entropy. So we could build, in practice they have 2048 states in the standard, for example, and 2048 states, and alphabet size is usually in bytes, so 256 size byte. So for example, in this FSC, this is implementation by Jan Koret, who is the author of many of these compressors like the standard, and also LZ4. Yes, and so the standard uses this table variant, also Apple LZFSS. So here are some examples. So compression speed, compression ratio, comparing to standard GZIP. So we can see that we have like much better compression or 4 times faster compression, and much we can get much better compression finally. And the compression is also like three, four times faster than GZIP. So there are reasons why it is replacing GZIP. Okay, so here is a summary of the two methods. So the final loop of encoder decoder is literally as written here. So for table variant we just use a table which can put for example in FPGA. Or some cheap sensor, we can just optimize this table for given probability distribution. Encoder also just uses tables, no multiplication. For runs we have this multiplication. Here is multiplication, yes, and here is division. So we need one multiplication, one division. But practical implementation can be made a very very parallel way. So we can make a vector in SIMD single input, so we can vector with synth and process many streams in such vectors. And there are many such implementations, reaching some enormous speeds. For GPU, it's like hundreds of gigabytes. There are available libraries from NVIDIA and Facebook. So TNS is used in this Apple, Facebook, the standard, LZ Turbon. So this is kind of Huffman generalized to add fractional bits. So it has no multiplication. So for example, for FPGA is very nice. It's a bit less memory efficient. It's costly to update. So we cannot freely change the probabilities. So usually just as for Huffman, we just fix the probabilities and work with them. But the advantage is also that we can simultaneously encrypt this data, so such encoded data. RANS is more and more is more popular now. So now most new compressors use RANS. So it needs one multiplication, but multiplication is very cheap recently. So it's good for a SIMD GPU. So for example, it used in this DNA compressor, this Razor adaptive neural networks use RANS, JPEG XL. So it's more flexible. We directly work on probabilities. We don't build the tables. We can modify the probabilities on the go, for example. Okay, so let's go to the history. So arithmetic coding was introduced by Riedemann and Pasco in 1976. But Martin a few years later reinvented, and many times reinvented. So without the patent system, it would be used probably 20 years earlier. But with the patent system, there were like 30 patents, and nobody has used it since, I think, this widely H.264 ABC video compressor. So there is nice example that patent system has paralyzed the development, not encouraged it arithmetic coding. For ANS, I have started it in 2006. Some first variant in my master thesis. Then 2007-8 there was some first interest, the TNS variant, some first implementations. But then there was six years break. Then finally Jan Kolet again has found it and started working with that and using, finally leading to this SHUF compressor, first compressor. Then also this year I have started RANS in this paper. And in 2004, the development started. For example, there was this important Fabian Gissen RANS paper for these fast implementations, James Bonfield fast implementations, with this Markov that depends on the previous symbol probabilities also used in this DNA compressor. Then the adaptive compressors, 2015. And so on, and many more. So in this link there are 100 of compressor implementations by various people. And unfortunately, there were also these patent vultures that there is something to get monopoly for, and you can get money for that. So there was one attempt I'm aware of. So maybe there are more we are not aware of. So one was some Storlab Markov RANS. So. There was some after some restrictions that they got some patent. Then there was this Google patent. So I have written on Google codec development group discussion group in 2014. They should use ANS in the video compressors. For 2.5 years, I have helped them in adaptation, hoping for some collaboration with my university. But then accidentally found out that they have trying to patent it. Literally, just standard video compressor with replaced standard arithmetic with ANS, as I have suggested them also. But finally, the patent was rejected, and it was quite a loud case. And now it's, I think it's completely abandoned. But a year ago, we have found out that there is a Microsoft patent which basically just describes the runs variant which everybody used for 5 years. So it was certain that it will be not granted. But I have checked the global dossiers. However, it turned out that it was granted. So there is a big question: what to do? So method used for 6 years. Now somebody got monopoly for this method. Everybody was using it for 6 years. We don't know what to do about it, what to think. Can we safely use JPEG Excel, which uses runs? So nobody knows. So claim one of this, of 28 of this patent, is just description of runs. Two-phase, as I have said, that is this formula and renormalization using probability information, so like entropy coders. One is the formula, one is the renormalization. In the patent, the formulas and pseudocode is just like taken from Wikipedia, but it was granted by USPTO. So there is a big question what to do about it, what to think about it, how to defend generally about it from these kind of situations. So this is the end. This is the final slide of my talk. So I would like to propose a discussion what to do. How to defend your work from patent vulture that you put something into a GitHub, into an article, and somebody just copy paste it into patent and got rubber stamped. What to do with this kind of situations? So in theory, the patent office should check also for various sources for prior art, but in practice they usually look only in patents. In theory, there is this third-party pre-issuance submission that you can, that knowing that there is an ongoing patent process, that you can send some prior art, but not necessarily it will be looked at because the patent officer has like 5 hours to check one patent, and then the patent is granted. That means that now Microsoft has monopoly for method everybody uses for 6 years, and we don't know what to do about it. So I don't know. So maybe there are some organizations which might help. I have put on each channel the discussion from Reddit, and there were suggested to two organizations: the Software Freedom Law Center and the Software Freedom Conservancy. I have written emails to them, but there was no response. So I don't know. So maybe there are some other ways to defend. So maybe there are needed some more initiatives to defend, because it's so simple to patent somebody's work. So it's really terrible. So how to organize it? So also the question if JPEG Excel can be used, because it was using runs before, but now the claims just describe what JPEG Excel is doing internally. So can we use it or not? Can Linux use it? Nobody knows. So also here is a nice link with a colleague of mine who has also related situation that somebody has just filed patents for methods they were using for years. And then the entire team has to only focus on defending the patents. So it's really terrible. Okay, so thank you very much for the attention, and I will gladly discuss now. So I'm looking at the ERC channel, so maybe let me put the links one more time there. Okay, thank you.
Tadita, is really, really fascinating talking. It's most wretched to hear that, you know, your work, and to see Microsoft be able to be granted a patent like that. That's, it's hard to see. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. What really struck me is it sounded like, based on the presentation, is this correct? Did I understand this correctly? If a patent's granted, it's really hard to remove that patent?
I don't know. So we, I think you need to go to a court, what costs like $100,000 or something. To get some lawyers in USA, because it is USPTO, and but they might expand to international. I don't know what to do about it. It's a terrible situation.
It's unbelievable that things like that can happen. Looking back, is there anything you think you would have done differently that could have helped the situation a little bit, or?
I don't know. So I monitor this pattern, and there are these global dossiers, and the global dossier looks right. There were some reviews, and they were negative. But then somebody writes on Wikipedia that the patent was granted, and indeed, it is that the patent was granted. But the global dossier don't see that it was granted. So it's really difficult to defend, what to do later on. It's a terrible situation. Yeah.
No, so, I understand.
The situation is very, very, I don't know. So also, there's a lot in the media. So maybe it's a good thing to use for to stimulate a wider discussion, actions, or so. Because the system is terrible now. So everybody can take your work from GitHub and put on the pattern that you have. You are defenseless, practically.
No, absolutely. It's really interesting, the JPEG XL concept that you wrote about, like the first of all, like Linux using that RANS stuff, because it reminds me exactly like the whole Oracle situation with ZFS and Linux, and it's interesting to see a lot of prevalence of that these days.
Yes,
do you think part of it, because you mentioned as well, like you've obviously worked in this field, you're at the dawn of it. That the USPTO, they might have like missed your work. Is that something? Do you have any ideas on why that would have happened? I feel like with the checks and balances.
I don't know. So I was monitoring the global dossier, but then the global dossier says a month before that then Google patent saying that there is a patent granted. So. I don't know. I'm not a lawyer, so maybe I'm wrong, so fine.
Yeah. Well, that's exactly, yeah, that's what I was thinking about. I want to be careful when I asked that question earlier. It's not that, it's sad to see that you have to put so much effort into just protecting what's already yours in that sense. And, you've shown the work, you've done your thesis, and to see it being used like that. But I also have to say, on the flip side, it's very impressive to see how widespread it is, right? You see it in the Apple technology. Yeah. In Facebook, it's really marvelous stuff.
Yes, so there's a lot of criticism that why I haven't patented it. So one problem is that making money from such patents is very difficult. So in practice, I think now nearly only large corporations can really make money. So single person from can sell a patent. So it's not very practical for small players. From the other. If there would be patents, it would be not used. But now it is used everywhere. So it's also very important to protect it from leaving the public domain because somebody rubber stamped it, monopoly for.
Yeah. I wonder if that could work in your advantage though too, because it's so ubiquitous that people, Apple might want to start supporting your efforts as well, and so potentially got some allies behind you. I really hope this works out.
Yeah, but for now, I don't know what to do about it. I'm searching for
it. I was looking over the comments on Reddit. Yeah, hopefully some of those organizations are going to be able to assist you there.
So if somebody has some idea, please contact me. And I'll gladly discuss them.
Is there your university website? Is that the best place to reach you? It has all the contact details.
There is my webpage. There are some email. Yeah. So you can email me or yeah.
You mind if I can post that in chat as well for those who are wondering that?
Yes, sure. So let me put my.
I have it here. So, there we go.
Oh, yes. Thanks.
Yeah. Excellent. It's actually. So, go ahead. Yeah. Sorry, Doctor.
There was a lot of fight, but this fight has ended like a few years ago. Everybody gave up. I think looks like that. I don't know. Because we have the small guys have no chance with the corporation.
Yeah, and of course, like it's such a brilliant system. Your focus is on the system itself; it's not on the whole legal side of things. So, yeah. It's really unfortunate that you have to spend so much energy doing that. We could be making I don't know if there's any specific improvements beyond what we've done, what you showed us today. But like, there's all kinds of things you can work on. So it drains us our energy, right?
Yeah, so this link is very nice. This the just describes some known methods, and then the team has to fight with the patterns. So it's terrible. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely. The university as well, they have a great promotional animation. I was looking at your website, and they have a really neat promotional animation on how to describe the whole process quite succinctly. It's very neat to see. A question for you as well, Dr. Duda. When your system, like Apple, of course, they've open sourced their yes. technology, but when the software is proprietary, it's much harder for you to track whether or not this system could be used in place further than what we know, because it could be like behind a proprietary paywall. Is that
Yes. So even if there is open source, there is no certainty that there are no patents behind it. So you need to be very, very careful. Yes,
absolutely. But it's a little bit challenging to keep track of all these implementations, I suppose, because you know it's so widespread at this point.
So it's why I have made this web page that there is 100 of links of implementations of compressors. So it'd be easy to find the prior art, but the patent officer has like 5 hours to find the prior art, and in practice only looks at patents. I have seen some documents and the only patents. That's all.
Absolutely. And talking specifically to the patents again there, Panos Salavera, I hopefully am pronouncing your name properly. Salavera, I believe. They just wrote in chat. There's of course the Free Software Foundation and Software Patents campaign as well. Perhaps something, your story can be brought up there as well.
I have written an article there.
Okay, I apologize. So many resources to keep track of.
But they only advertise that we should fight with patents, but there are some actual situations when we need to fight with this specific patent, but what to do in this situation. So, and also I think that this case is very nice to use for the general discussion, to deny the discussion, because it's going back to the history 30 years ago, the arithmetic coding patents, and again repeating the history.
Yeah, absolutely. And hopefully through this experience we'll be able to find some new different strategies to tackle this.
So thanks for if anybody has any comment, please write to me.
Yeah, that'd be perfect. Dr. Another question as well, if you don't mind. In terms sure. of, about 7 minutes to the clock here. The ANS technology, like the system you developed, has that been able to spark? It's focused on the compression aspect, but any of those concepts were able to transition them to other fields. I see you're working on machine learning and other fields of that nature, which are very data intensive, of course.
So indeed there are many neural network based compressors. So often they use ANS as the final place, because so ANS has one disadvantage, that is the LIFO, that last in first out. So you need to read from the reverse direction. It's much more convenient to do it. But there is one algorithm with BBANS now, which requires LIFO. So it is why they use ANS. This one plus also this simultaneous and encrypt. This is an application that usually the remote sensors don't have any compression nor encryption, and you can do both in one chip layer. So this is very nice, I think. Direction which will go.
Oh, that's excellent. Yeah, it's such a prominent field these days. I suppose all kinds of concepts tie, and it's neat that you can use it so directly. It sounds like. I'm also looking into this as well. Is it true? So, email HTML, you can use DNS for the compression as well in email.
So I it's only a part of data compressor, the last phase. So, but I know that the standard is in this that it is and
yeah, application is yesterday, I believe, right?
Yes. So it is in a few places. So in theory, you could.
Yeah. Oh, that's excellent! Wow. Such a core part of the computer science side of things. I'm really pleased to see you didn't patent, and I'm really sorry to see what happened because of that. But to stick firm with your stance, that's really admirable.
Some question. Yeah. So if I have considered filing a patent application, it's very costly and difficult, and then there are many variations of methods. So you would need to find 20 patents, and then the problem that you create a patent minefield. So nobody save them. So also if I have had a patent, then somebody else could have very similar patents nearby, and somebody else another, and then nobody can use it. And this has happened with RFID coding. So I'm fine to invalidate the patent, and that's all. I got some suggestion that maybe to try to do something else with this patent, but I just want to invalidate because it clearly describes your art.
Yeah, absolutely. That's an interesting question, Panos. Tricky. It almost seems like a good hack, but on the other side, you're playing into the game. And
yes. It's good. So if you talk with Python lawyers, then want you to patent everything because they take percentages. But I it's not a good idea. So still somebody else can get a patent very near, and then there are 20 patents around, and it's impossible to use the method. And I'm just again, I don't want to have any patent around.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that perspective as well. It reminds me of the IP stuff, and of course we can get into the GPL and things from pretty quickly from a discussion like that. But something to be mindful, and I didn't quite realize to what extent this can affect people. And your story has been very fascinating to hear, Dr. Duda. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes, but I think there can be more stories like that, and only some of them are loud in media, and many are just not even the author doesn't know that somebody has patented his work, and maybe can find it accidentally a few years later. And yeah, so I think there is needed some especially need for checking also. Other prior art, not only patents, because now they only check patents in practice.
Absolutely. So. Yeah, it reminds me of the patent trolls too. And what's interesting is that it affects both the proprietary and free software. With like last year's talk at LP 2021, there was the GNOME Foundation was talking about their defense on a couple of their software, and to see, you know, like that side of things is problematic. But to me, it's even more heartbreaking to see someone, you know, you put your life into ANS, you've dedicated your thesis to that, and to see it to see the system kind of fail like this, it's really disheartening.
Yeah, not getting better, but only worse. Even more and more patents.
No, exactly.
And people are large corporations to get the complete monopoly of everything.
Yeah, because it's easy for them to pick up some patents from other companies and then move on from that. And thanks, Michael. Yeah, it's the Shotwell case for GNOME, the application. Patent trolls, I believe, were using the patenting the idea of like photo sharing, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, my time has
yes. Ended. Thank you so much for presenting today. It's wonderful.
Thank you for listening and for discussion. So please contact me if there is some idea of what to do with this pattern, and generally maybe some action to ignite some discussion maybe on this case, which was already a lot of media.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you so much. We'll be in touch.
Nice meeting you. And bye.